Hi everyone, welcome to the first session of the IBIS Prep Cram Course for the July 2022 Florida Bar Exam. This is going to meet on Saturdays and Sundays from 11 to 2, and we're going to cover everything. One of my favorite sayings is we're going to leave no stone unturned. So this is a place for people to come and ask questions, and hopefully I'll have the answer. I usually do, but if not, there's a team of resources around us, other people taking the test. So we'll get to the bottom of everything. Everyone should have access to this drive. And you can access Florida Part A. And if you don't have access, don't worry, Simran will give you access. But we're actually gonna start today with the MBE outline. And we're gonna start with contracts because contracts is a fundamental subject on the exam. Contracts is a subject that most people should know pretty well. They understand the basics. It's tested a lot as an essay subject, and it's manageable as an essay subject. It's tested always as an MBE subject, very difficult actually as an MBE subject. People don't get the super high scores in contract that they think they deserve because the questions are tricky. Fair enough. So we're going to do our diligence to really go over contracts pretty thoroughly. There's a lot of different ways we can go over contracts. I'll just kind of show you. One thing that I've done and I'm going to require everyone to do, this is going to be part of your assigned homework every week, is going to be making your own cram guides from practice questions. So everyone out there should have a question bank they're using. If not, reach out to me or Simran. We can help set you up, whether it be Adaptabar or UWorld or any question bank. But we're huge proponents of doing practice questions over and over and over again and getting the right answers. But that, just doing that repetitively, is not super effective. What's super effective is taking the time after every single question to meditate on the question and document what it is that you really learned from that question. It might not be what the correct answer was point blank. It might be a reason why the incorrect answer, the answer that you chose, was incorrect. But there should always be a learning lesson from every single question. And we got to do this to stimulate the memory device. There's a book I read called Moonwalking with Einstein, and it's about memory and how to memorize things. And what it says is visualize, associate things with images or acronyms or whatever it may be. Like if I want to memorize someone's name and their name is, I'm just seeing Jackson, I could think of like Jackson, Mississippi. Oh, Mississippi, you know, I'll just think of that state on the map. Now I'm like, oh, Jackson, that's, you know, like, even though he has nothing to do with Mississippi and I would never tell him that that's the association, we want to take that type of thinking as much as possible. It really does work, that like acronyms or image association, but let's try to become robotic where I could just pull a string out of your back and you could just recite memorized facts as much as possible. Now, how do I recommend doing that with the practice questions? Is meditating on the question and then writing like pretty succinct lessons from each question, right? And then ideally you'll have big old pages like this. Now, you could just take the short route and just read our cram guides, but they're not full. They'll never be full. There's too many questions out there. I'm gonna continue to add on them myself for fun, but you should take the time to read through our cram guides and then take the time always to have a bank of your own cram guides or whatever you want to call it, where you're just simply documenting the memorized lesson from each question. You want to do the best you can to memorize the question and the answer so that when you're taking it on test day and they're like, Sally's at the playground and, you know, Tommy throws a football and hits her in the head, it reminds you of the same question type, but it's like, not at a playground, it's at a nursery school. So you know what I'm saying? Like, you want to really be able to associate the actual question, the actual answer, how you how you put it down on paper. We really want to take the time to understand that memorization is the key to this. It's so much information, and we have to get good at memorizing things. And I think that's the best technique. So, you know, just kind of, I'll read some of these before we get into the outline, just to kind of show you, demonstrate what they mean. Unilateral contracts can be accepted by performance. If a school offers a reward for a writing competition and someone writes the essay, they've accepted the offer and it cannot be rescinded. Now, what does that remind me of? The dog poster, right? The reward for the dog. If someone says reward, $1,000 if they find this dog, and you find the dog, does that count as acceptance? It does, because it's a unilateral contract. So can anyone else think of another unilateral contract that we might see on an MBE question for contracts? Something that could be only accepted by performance? Nothing, Bueller? I mean, I'm just asking you guys for a hypothetical, so don't even worry about it. But just the idea that unilateral means there doesn't need to be the typical elements of a contract, the offer, the acceptance, the consideration, you know, all those different elements. It just needs to be simple performance. Do they need to have knowledge of it being in place? Like, let's say there's a wanted dog poster and someone finds a dog and returns it and they had no idea about it. And then a couple of days later, they see the poster and they call them and say, hey, I saw there was a reward for this. Should I get my money back? What do you think?
There's supposed to be a mutual, at least at one point, some type of mutual. Right. What does that mean? Still too fresh in barbaric times.
Right. There needs to be some, you know, mutual assent, meeting of the minds. There needs to be some sort of understanding that a contract has been formed in that moment. It can't be subsequent that you're like, oh, actually, now I'm returning this. Like, you had to return the dog knowing that you were returning the dog for a specific reason. And we'll see that MBE questions get really intricate into the details. But let's look at a couple more of these. I love this one. Delegation refers to duties, not rights under a contract, right? Delegation refers to duties, whereas assignment will refer to rights. And then novation is if there's going to be a complete substitution of the parties. So we definitely want to make sure we know the difference between delegation, assignment, and novation. I don't want to jump too far into these elements of contracts without starting from the way beginning, but I just want to demonstrate what the point of that was. The point is that I want you to go through the specific questions, which we're going to do in the second half of class today. We're going to go through specific MBE questions and, you know, tease out the answers, but I want you to do that as much as possible on your own. In the meantime, let's begin from the way beginning and kind of understand what contracts are all about. And feel free to chime in, make this as interesting as possible, but I do need to do this. I do need to start with a fundamental lecture of contracts. Okay, so what is a contract? A contract is a legally enforceable agreement or promise. That's good language if you're writing an essay. A contract is a legally enforceable agreement or promise, and the law recognizes a duty to perform and provides a remedy in the event of a breach. Okay, we just talked about unilateral versus bilateral. Unilateral, all you need is performance, where bilateral, anything other than a unilateral contract. And we'll talk about the elements of offer, acceptance, consideration. A quasi-contract. So we'll talk about quasi-contracts as a form of an equitable remedy. Remedies being like damages, you know, there's going to be legal damages, which are going to be monetary damages. And then there's going to be equitable damages, which are going to be when the court orders something to happen. Now, a quasi-contract is going to be when the court pretty much orders a contract to exist, even though one didn't exist. That's why they call it a quasi-contract. It's kind of like a court-ordered contract. So just kind of understand that term. Things to look for in a contract: if there's a benefit conferred, they expect to be paid, they accept the benefit, and they'll be unjustly enriched if it's not compensated. That's for a quasi-contract. The main thing to look for a quasi-contract would be there would be unjust enrichment if we didn't install a contract. So someone needs to get paid, and so the court needs to impose a contract. Not going to focus on that. Basics: unilateral, bilateral, unilateral accepted by performance, bilateral, anything other. This is an interesting one, and I'm going to do my best to call things interesting. It's contract law. Void, voidable, and unenforceable. Okay. Just to make sure no one's like sleeping out there. I've literally had people sleep in my lectures before. What's an example of a voidable contract?
An example of a voidable contract would be like minors.
Yes, and on who may void the contract?
The minor.
And does the minor have to void the contract?
No, that's why you go into the voidable.
Exactly. Voidable means they can, they may elect, but they don't have to. So if you make a contract with a 17-year-old and the contract goes awry, the 17-year-old can void the contract. If you make a contract with a 17-year-old and the 17-year-old, it's great for him, he can elect to enforce the contract. It's on his behalf. Whereas a void contract never had any legal effect. Void contract is a contract for drugs, a contract for trafficking, human trafficking, right? It's just there's no legal effect to it. You were not allowed to have this contract under law. Unenforceable means that there is a contract, there is a valid contract. There's no problems with the way it's written. It's just unenforceable because of a contract-related defense. Incapacity, duress, right? That's a good example, duress, where, look, this contract looks great on paper, but we can prove that you forced me to sign it. Therefore, it's unenforceable. So voidable is, you know, one party legally has the right to void it because of their status. Unenforceable is the way it was actually formed. And then void means that it never has any legal effect. All right, so when we talk about contracts, we start the way beginning. But because everyone in here is taking both sections, MBE and Florida, they overlap a lot. So I'll say things in terminology that you can kind of apply to essays too. And when writing an essay, one of the first things that you could say is, the first issue is whether or not a contract exists. A contract is a legally enforceable agreement or promise in which there are adequate remedies at law. Contracts are either governed by the UCC or the common law. And again, who's awake out there? What contracts are UCC and what contracts are common law?
UCC is for sale of goods. Common law is for land and everything else.
Exactly. UCC is sale of goods. Contract is land. And I'm sorry, common law will be land and anything other than goods. Okay. If both parties to the contract are merchants, and we know this K means merchants, the UCC has additional special rules, including the perfect tender, acceptance with additional terms. Okay, that's important to know. Merchants, there's gonna be special rules for merchants. If you note something today, note that you must know all the special rules that apply to merchants under the UCC. Okay. Who can tell you about the predominant purpose test besides Sam?
If the contract has like mixed goods, if it involves one for services, for example, one for goods, then you look to the predominant purpose of what is embedded into contract to determine what it will fall under, the applicable law it will fall under.
Yeah, a good way of thinking about that is, our services. We provide tutoring services, but we also have some materials, right? So if you bought a package from us, is it going to be the UCC or is it going to be common law? The answer is likely under the predominant purpose test, the common law would apply because the majority of what we do under the contract is for the sale of services. Now, you can have a divisibility of contract, right? You can argue for divisibility of contract, which means that if you can segregate the goods and the services by price terms and be like, look, they're clearly these goods are this price term, these services are that price term, you could argue for divisibility of contract and apply different law to each contract. But as a main understanding, we're going to use the predominant purpose test. Now, again, thinking as an essay writer, we're going to frame every essay pretty much like this. The first issue is whether there's a contract. A contract is an enforceable agreement between two parties in which there's an adequate remedy at law. Contracts are either governed by the UCC or common law. The UCC is going to apply to the sale of goods, while common law applies to land and services. Courts will apply the predominant purpose test when there is a contract that includes goods and services, which means that the main purpose of the contract would dictate the applicable law. That's like a good little header to any contracts essay, and it's a good understanding of the formation of contract law. So we're going to get into, I'll skip this for right now. I want to talk about the main points of the contract: offer, acceptance, consideration, and no valid defenses. It is important that you have memorized word for word what the definitions of these things are, because when you're writing an essay, you don't want to spend time being like, what an offer is. You know, you want to just write the same thing every time. So a manifestation of a present intent to contract. That's not bad. Demonstrated by a promise, undertaking, or commitment, definite in certain terms, and communication to an offeree. An offer creates a power of acceptance in the offeree. That's a good point. The offeree being the person who's accepting the offer. What about a newspaper advertisement? Is that going to be an offer?
No, that's usually an invitation to offer.
Invitation to offer. But I like how you said the word usually, because when could it be an offer?
I guess that would be, like you were saying before, some examples of unilateral contracts where there's an advertisement that says first come, first serve.
Something. Right. It has specific details of how to accept, so that a reasonable person would say, okay, I know where I need to be. I know what I need to do. I know what I need to pay. Right. It more or less creates a unilateral contract. Most of the time, a newspaper advertisement would be an invitation.
Stop.
Objective manifestation of intent. Would a reasonable person believe that communication is an offer inviting acceptance? Okay, what are the material terms required under the UCC? So the quantity must be certain or capable of being certain. What about the price? Does there need to be a price under the UCC for a contract?
No, I think quantity for UCC.
No price, right? And what will the price be if there's no price? What will the courts decide?
I think they supplement it by, I guess, like the market value, or?
Exactly, by customary trade.
Course of dealings and course of performance.
Things like that.
Let's
just kind of see, you know, what I did skip over real quick. But distinctions between UCC and common law. Okay, this is good to go over. So the mirror image rule, right? We understand that the mirror image rule under common law means that the acceptance has to match the offer exactly. There can't be an additional term. If there's an additional term, what does that constitute? A counteroffer, right? A counteroffer. But under the UCC, if both parties are merchants, right, that's a little distinction right there. If they're both merchants and we're talking the UCC, then the additional term will become part of the contract unless it materially changes the offer or the offeror objects within a reasonable time, usually 10 days. But let's break that down a little bit. What does that mean? It means that services, land, mirror image. If you say, I want this plot of land right here, and you say, I'll give you a plot of land that's just a little bit different, that totally is going to be a counteroffer. But under the UCC, if they're both merchants and there's just a slight change, like 105 instead of 100, then that's going to be considered an additional term that is going to be part of the contract. Unless the person says, hey, wait up, you accepted 105, I said 100. Then that would be like objection from the offeror. But if they're both merchants under the UCC and it's a slight change, not material, then it will become part of the contract. Fair enough. Option contracts, and we look for these on essays too. What is an option contract? So can anyone give me like a definition of an option contract, how they perceive it? What's an example of an option contract?
It's like when they give you time to accept the offer pretty much, and they already lay out what the contract will be.
That's what we mean by an options contract, that I am offering my services and this offer will remain open for 30 days, something of that nature. So for someone to accept that, you know, to be able to exercise that option, there has to be some sort of consideration under the common law. If there's going to be, you know, I am more or less paying for that option. You know, I'm putting something down. I'm putting some skin in the game to have a 30-day window, which means that I have a 30-day window to accept these services because I put down some consideration. If someone else takes those services and now I no longer have the option of utilizing those services, that constitutes a breach, right? Because you, I put consideration down and I relied upon it. Reliance is the other thing too. Like I had already planned on this. So that's what they mean by an option contract. You're ensuring the right to exercise, you're ensuring the right to accept an offer. Now there has to be consideration under the common law. Under UCC, again, if it's a merchant and it's a firm offer, we talk about these firm offers, then no consideration is required. Because why are these rules different from merchants here? Because merchants are people that deal with each other all the time. We can't, like, you know, let every merchant just get out of a contract in this course of dealing. We have to be like, all right, you guys are merchants. You know, there's no consideration necessary. You're accustomed to dealing with each other. So for that option contract, does anyone know what it typically is, the time frame that they stay open for? Not to exceed how many days?
I guess 90 days. I'm not sure.
90 days, right. It's typically 90 days. So if you're writing an essay, you might want to say under the UCC, a firm offer typically lasts 90 days, but it can be a specific time or reasonable period of time. If it's not stated, we're going to go with 90 days. So we understand mirror image rule applies for common law. If they're merchants, an additional term is actually going to be part of the contract unless it materially alters the contract. We understand that an option contract, what that represents, it represents that there's a period of time for which you can accept the contract. And under the UCC, if they're merchants, no consideration is necessary. There has to be consideration if it's just a common law option contract. Again, modifications has to be consideration under common law. Under the UCC, only needs to be good faith. You see, it doesn't necessarily have to be merchants for the contract modification. It just needs to be good faith. Substantial performance versus perfect tender. So we understand what perfect tender means. That's when, you know, you order the widgets, they have to be delivered exactly as you expected them to be. Now, can anyone tell me what is your means of recourse if they deliver non-conforming goods? What can you do? I'm accepting widgets. I'm expecting 100 blue widgets. And instead I get 80 red widgets. What can I do at that moment?
You can reject it.
Yeah, you can reject it.
Reject it entirely, right?
Or you could accept it and for the price difference.
Exactly. If you are the acceptor of non-conforming goods, you actually have some leeway of what you're going to do. You're not forced to accept goods that you didn't want, right? You're not forced to take accept in part. You can reject it entirely. You can reject it in part, or you could do what Ben's saying and utilize, you know, what you can, and then sue for the remaining breach. You can never be unjustly enriched. I was going to say duly compensated, but that's not really a thing. You can never be unjustly enriched, right? You can always get what you deserve under contract. And we're going to always think back to that when we're thinking about contract law. The purpose of contract law, and Joel can tell you, my uncle is literally a contract attorney. Just an aside, my uncle said that he didn't do well in contracts in law school. And that's kind of like what makes me laugh, because he's like the best contract attorney I've ever met. So law school is just not a great indicator of anything in my nature. It's just, in my opinion, it's just like a test that you have to get through. Just like the bar exam. Just how well you do on the bar exam is not a great indicator of how well you're going to be as an attorney. It's just a test that you got to get through. So the purpose of contracts is just to make the non-breaching party whole again, to put them in the position they would have been if the contract had been rightfully exercised. That's the whole purpose of this. So perfect tender means you have to, you know, supply a perfect tender. That's UCC, that's goods, that's widgets. Now, common law, we're going to have substantial performance. If there's substantial performance, then the other party must pay or perform. So if you're building, you know, you're building something and you build 3/4 of the building, that's going to constitute substantial performance. And you'll be, you know, if they tell you to stop building, you're going to at least be compensated for the amount you've done. I'll tell everyone right now, that's where a lot of MBE contracts questions get difficult, is how should you be compensated, right? Like if you're the builder and you've built this building and then they tell you, oh, we need you to stop building, we're going to change our plans. Well, you're like, well, yo, I've already been building this building, right? So like, do I get, now it's a tough question though. Do you get paid just for what you've built? Do you get paid what you expected to be built? Like if the contract was completed, it kind of depends on the fact pattern, right? They'll usually tell you some other facts that, like, you know, then Tom went and took another job Like, again, you can't be unjustly enriched. You're not going to be able to get paid for the one project while you're going to be doing another project and getting paid for that. So the fact patterns will usually dictate the means of recourse. But just know that with contracts, the remedies part is, especially with MBE, is usually the most difficult. What is the proper form of remedy for the breach that we have? So we have substantial performance, perfect tender, contract modification, option contracts, and mirror image rule. We understand all these distinctions between the UCC and the common law. Keep an eye out for them, very important. All right, offer, we talked about, they can't be super vague. Real estate, important, requires price and identification of the land, right? An actual description. While we're there, can anyone humor me and tell me what the acronym MyLEG stands for? These are contracts that must conform with the statute of frauds and thereby be evidenced in writing and signed by the party to be charged. What does MyLEG stand for?
Marriage contracts that can't be completed within 1 year. I think modifications are also in there, part of the M's, I think. Executorship.
You skipped the L, the one we're talking about.
Sorry, land contracts. Yeah, I was just trying to go in order. Contracts for land. Contracts for goods over 500. And surety ships.
Solid. And can someone else humor me, because I need everyone to know this. What is a guarantorship and what is a surety ship? What does it mean?
The surety, I think, is like when someone takes out a loan and you're or a mortgage or anything like that, and you're I think putting down your name or assets as surety to that loan, to that debt. I think so. Something along those lines.
Sure. And what about a guarantor. I mean, I'm sorry, what about an executor? I'm sorry, that is a guarantor. What about an executorship?
Need some, I'm gonna phone a friend for this one.
Executors, okay. A guarantor and a surety are more or less the same thing.
Well, executorship is like for like a deceased, like a will.
Right,
okay. Or like a trust.
Right.
Well, like, more like a will.
Right, someone who's going to make the decisions for another when they lack capacity towards the end of their life, their executor, their estate, for instance. Okay, so we got marriage, contracts over a year, land, executorships, goods over $500, and suretyships. So this land also not only needs to be reduced into writing, but has to have the price and, you know, the meets and bounds or whatever, the real estate. Okay, communication to an identified offeree. They must know of the offer and have the power to accept it. That's what we were talking about with the dog poster. Like, they actually have to know about it. You can't just be like, here's your dog, and then call them a week later and be like, oh yeah, I want my money. Advertisements are not offers unless highly specific as to quantity and clearly indicate who may accept. This is the exception. Joel talked about that. Okay. Termination, offer may be terminated by an act of a party by operation of law, revocation by the offeror, like you have the power. The offeror has a lot of power. I can dig, actually I take that offer back. Rejection by the offeree, once you reject it, you know, that terminates the offer. Unless it's a one of those open contracts that we're talking about, an options contract, or a lapse of time. Don't forget the offeror is the master of the offer. Let's just say that. Reasonable lapse of time, you know, we can argue about what that may be. And then operation of law, death or insanity of either party, look for that. They definitely ask that on the MBE. Like, one person dies, that's going to discharge the responsibilities of the contract. Not always, you know, if it could be an estate, but as a matter of course, if it's like you and one person and it doesn't contemplate, you know, their estate being a party to it, it would rescind the contract. Destruction of proposed contract subject matter, right? Or a supervening illegality. These will make them void. Okay, so revocation, you can revoke the offer, that'll terminate it. Unambiguous statement, or they become aware of their unambiguous comment or statement to other. So this is similar to constructive notice here. Like, I make an offer to do some, I have an outstanding offer, and then I tell someone else that offer no longer is valid, and then someone else explicitly has knowledge that I told that person that the offer is no longer valid. That's what they're saying. So you had constructive notice. You knew that offer was no longer valid, so therefore you did not have the power to accept it. It was, you were constructively notified of it. We'll see that word constructive notice come up in real estate and other things. Constructive notice means like you weren't explicitly told of it, but it's like inquiry notice. You should have known and therefore put on constructive notice. So that'd be a method of revocation. Now we talked about these option contracts, right? It's irrevocable if they put consideration. And the UCC, if they offer to sell it and assign writing and give assurances, it will be held open. It's also irrevocable. So that's if the firm offers are signed in writing and give assurances. All right. No consideration is required for the irrevocable offers under the UCC. There is consideration for it under common law. Detrimental reliance must be reasonable. There's some questions on the MBE about detrimental reliance for sure. Unilateral contracts, the start of performance makes the offer irrevocable for a reasonable time to complete performance. So if there's whoever paints this thing first will get paid, and you start painting it, then they have to let you finish it. It must go beyond mere preparation, though. You actually have to start painting the fence. Different ways that you can reject the offer. I kind of skip over this. All right, acceptance. We talked about acceptance, the mirror image rule for common law. Acceptance with additional terms. If they're both merchants, that additional part term will become part of the contract unless it materially changes it. Now, on a essay, you kind of argue that. Is it a material term or not? On the MBE, you kind of have to be a little bit more dialed in on what is material and what's immaterial. Anyone kind of think what would be something material that would change an additional term? Like
if you're contracting for dogs and then all of a sudden you want to change the contract for cats,
cats and dogs, right? Very material. If it was like cats that weighed 45 pounds and now they're going to be cats that weigh 50 pounds, these are fat cats, maybe that's immaterial. But, you know, they try to make it obvious. You want to, as you're doing these MBE questions, and we're going to do in the second part of class, you want to dial in on what's being tested here, how are they testing it, and what's the correct answer. So we'll try to do that. Acceptance by prompt shipment, right? A merchant may accept an offer to buy goods by either providing a promise to ship the goods by written confirmation, promptly shipping conforming goods, and the shipment of non-conforming goods may rise to a breach. We talked about that. Now, I always like this mailbox rule, because I watched the episode, someone forced me to watch it, of Kim Kardashian studying for the California baby bar exam. And she could not understand the mailbox rule. And I was like, she's going to fail the test. And sure enough, she did. Can anyone explain to me the mailbox rule and how that works? They definitely test this.
So basically, if you send an offer, the offer becomes valid once the intended recipient has possession of the offer. Once it's received, versus an acceptance, it's the second you put it in the mailbox, it's considered to be a valid acceptance. Revocation, I believe, is the same as an offer, where you have to receive it in order to know that it's been revoked, so that because someone could accept it before receiving the revocation.
Exactly. The offers and the revocations, the things that are tied to the offer, they actually have to have knowledge of. But the acceptance, that means as of that moment, the contract has been accepted. So it just needs to be sent and put in the mail. That's pretty solid. So an offeree may accept partial performance for bilateral contracts, complete performance for unilateral contracts, unless acceptance is limited by the terms of the offer. So, you know, acceptance is kind of easy. The offer may always limit the methods of acceptance. Kind of skip forward a little bit. Consideration. Consideration just means that there has to be something to support the promise. It can't just be words. So it has to be a bargain for legal detriment incurred by either party to a contract of, okay. Consideration is a bargain for exchange of legal detriment or benefit in Florida. A bargain for exchange of legal detriment and benefit, meaning that one party actually has something to lose and the other party has something to gain in this contract. So it must induce the detriment, and the detriment, it must induce the promise. Something they test a whole lot is this pre-existing legal duty, or like if you already owed someone money and now, you know, you promised to pay that money you already owed them, does that constitute consideration? And it does get difficult. We'll do some questions. Sometimes it may constitute like a novation if they switch a party and now they're going to pay the debt. Sometimes it may be consideration. Sometimes it may not. We'll go through them. A lot of this stuff, I'm just giving you the foundation to get our wheels turning. Like, okay, this is the stuff we're going to zero in on. And then the second half of class, we're just going to do questions together and really see like, oh, that's really how they test it. And that's what we're going to learn from. So that's something we'll see a lot. Legal, the is there consideration and what is consideration? And legal detriment means an obligation to do or refrain from doing something one would not otherwise be obligated to do or refrain from doing. You know, hey kid, I promise, you know, if I play in the game tomorrow, then you get this reward. You are already obligated to play in the game tomorrow. That's your job. You're a baseball player. So there has to be an obligation to do something that you were not otherwise obligated or to refrain, that you're not otherwise obligated to do. It has to be you're promising something detrimental. It could be refraining to do something. It could be doing it, but it has to be something that you're not otherwise going to have to refrain from doing. Substitutes for consideration reliance or estoppel. We'll talk about this. If, you know, there'd be an injustice, they reasonably relied on it, and they acted upon that reasonable reliance, then even though there's no consideration, they'll still enforce the promise. We kind of talked about that with the quasi-contracts. Consideration is not necessary for good faith written modifications to a contract covered by the UCC. We talked about that a few times, that you need consideration if it's common law, but if it's a modification under the UCC, no consideration is necessary for a modification so long as it's in good faith and in writing. All right, we talk about this a lot. So I'm molding right here because this is the lecture part. And trust me, we're gonna do a lot of lecturing, but a lot of fun too. But I try to make it as interesting as possible, but it's just not that interesting. But when I think about contracts, I always try to say it out loud from the top. What is a contract? A contract is an agreement between two or more parties in which there are remedies at law. Contracts can be bilateral, which requires the offer, acceptance, and consideration, or unilateral, in which performance will suffice to bind the contract. For there to be an offer and acceptance, well, before I even get to that, contracts could be under the UCC or the common law. The UCC is going to apply to goods. Common law is going to apply to land and services. When we talk about offer and acceptance, some key buzzwords you want to think about are meeting of the minds, mutual assent, intent to be bound by the terms in a way that the offeree would reasonably understand to constitute an offer, things of that nature. So we have the offer, we have the acceptance, and then we have the consideration. The consideration is going to be a bargain for exchange of legal detriment or benefit in Florida. We kind of feel confident about that. We also want to talk about the predominant purpose test, meaning, okay, it's mostly about services, so we're going to look at the predominant purpose and say that this is going to be a common law contract. We're also going to think about the mirror image rule, in which the mirror image rule under the common law, it needs to be exact, the terms of the acceptance and the offer, or else it constitutes a counteroffer. We want to know about perfect tender, meaning that under the UCC, you have to give them the exact amount of widgets that they wanted. We want to know about the differences for merchants and what really applies to merchants. One thing about merchants is that under the UCC, if both parties are merchants, an additional term will not constitute a counteroffer, but will indeed be part of the contract so long as it does not materially alter the contract. Merchants, so too, under the UCC, a modification does not require additional consideration. So, you know, the stuff that I'm saying right now hopefully sounds kind of repetitive and basic, but there's a smoothness to it that I want you all to acquire, where you can just roll these things off. So we're not on test day being like, what is an offer? What is an acceptance? We really have our language fine-tuned, and we can really just spend our time in class focused on practice questions and going through practice essays. All right, now I've gone through my outline. Offer, acceptance, consideration, no valid defenses. The first valid defense that we always think of is the statute of frauds, right? And we talked about this. We all need to memorize what the statute of frauds is. The statute of frauds, there are certain contracts that must conform with the statute of frauds and be evidenced in writing and signed by the party to be charged. Fair enough. Those are my legs. And we talked about what that acronym stands for. Marriage contracts that cannot be completed under 1 year. So let's think about this. What if I have a leasing agreement that is 2 years long? That needs to be in writing because it's over 2 years. What if I have one that is 10 months, but it's gonna start in 3 months? And think about that. Me and Tommy agree to a 10-month lease to start in 3 months. Now, 10 plus 3 is 13. That's more than me. Does that need to be in writing? Anyone else out there?
No.
I have no and a yes.
I'm leaning towards yes also.
All right, we're getting closer. Now it's like a Milwaukee-Boston series. Anyone else? The answer to this one is actually no. It does not need to be in writing because we're going to look at the contract from the date it starts to the date it ends, not the date in which we agreed upon it, right? So it's the actual contract itself. Now, what if we have a contract that I am going to provide tutoring services to you until the day I die? Does that need to be in writing?
No.
No, who said no? And explain why. And don't be afraid to say why. Just say it. I'm not scared. Just say it.
No, because I mean, technically you could die tomorrow and it won't last a year. It's too open.
That could not be completed within a year. That contract could be completed in 1 year. How could it be completed in 1 year? I die tomorrow. Why'd you have to say tomorrow? You could have given me at least 3 months. You know, I'm trying to have a good summer. But yeah, that's sorry. The way we got to think about contracts that can be not completed in 1 year. So marriage, contracts in consideration of marriage. Now, technically, unless statutorily defined, a postnup wouldn't have to be in writing because it's not in contemplation of marriage. A prenup would have to be. Now, most states have statutes that say postnups need to be in marriage. But under the, you know, my legs, it's contracts in contemplation of marriage. So MYL, contracts of land, we got that. E, executorships. Goods are $500 suretyships. Look for that goods under 500. You know, if it's a $300 contract, they'll get you on that. So let's just, you know, zero in on that. Okay, so we're talking about defenses to formation. The first one is statute of frauds. Now, there's a bunch more. There's a bunch of I's. I know this. When we're thinking about defenses to formation, there's a bunch of I's. Illegality, intoxication, incapacity, infancy maybe. Whatever. There's a bunch of I's. I just remember that. There's a bunch of R's when it comes to equitable defenses, like reformation, rescission, replevant. So I don't know, letter things. But let's think about these defenses to contract. Incapacity. Promisor lacks capacity. So that could be they're drunk. So incapacity is intoxication. Incapacity could be they're too young, infancy. That's what incapacity is gonna mean. Contract can be enforced against a party that lacked capacity at the time the contract was formed if they have since gained capacity and retained the benefits. So I'm drunk at the bar. I tell you I'm going to give you my tutoring services. And then I sober up and I say, yep, I'm going to give you those services. That would be ratified because once I got sober, I had the capacity to affirm. Also, look for that with the underage kid. You know, they make a contract at 17 and then at 18, they do something that affirms a contract either expressly or tacitly. It's not the word I was looking for, but you know, look for that type of a situation. Statute of frauds, we talked about illegality, right? That's a defense to a contract. It has an illegal purpose or supervening illegality, what we're going to do becomes illegal. You know, we are going to contract to sell Bitcoins and then they made Bitcoins illegal. Well, now that contract is not going to happen. Misrepresentation and fraud, definitely want to look at, especially in these residential real estate contracts. We're going to see, you know, they have a duty to, under Johnson v. Davis, to tell you about any of the known defects, anything they should have known in the house. You have more of a duty if it's a residential real estate than if it's commercial real estate when it comes to, you know, representation. But, you know, we're going to look for fraud, misrepresentation, duress, they put a gun to your head, unconscionability, that means it's unconscionable. Like no one in the world would ever agree to that. That's ridiculous. Those terms, you're going to charge me a penny for me to build the, you know, a statue, like that was unconscionable. You were in such a position of power. That's a better way of thinking about it. You were in such a position of power that you made this unconscionable contract. Illusory, you know, a contract is illusory. Kind of means a similar thing that like it doesn't really exist. It's illusory. You're in such a position of power. That's what unconscionable means, that it's like unconscionable. No one would do that. illusory is more that bargaining power that is an illusory contract. So kind of clarify them. I told you there's a lot of I's. Quasi-contract, I don't know why we keep talking about quasi-contract. Unconscionability, unfair bargaining power, if it's procedurally, oppressive terms, that's what I was looking for. Unconscionable means there's oppressive terms. Arises with contracts of adhesion, exculpatory clauses. So I've seen that word before and didn't know what it mean. A contract of adhesion, that's when there's oppressive terms. Whereas unfair bargaining power would probably be more of an illusory contract. Misunderstanding. Okay, so a big one. If I'm going through my head on this, on defenses to contract, first one I'm thinking of always is statute of frauds. The second one I'm thinking of is actually mistake, because there can be a mutual and a unilateral mistake. Can someone tell me what's the difference of the effect of a mutual versus a unilateral mistake?
If it's mutual, then both the parties can leave the contract, but if it's only one person is mistaken, then the contract is avoidable by the non-mistaken part.
Right, unless the non-mistaken party knew of the other party's mistake and essentially took advantage of them. But yes, if you and I, Sam, make an agreement and it's over tutoring services and I say it's $1,200, but you say it's $1,250, and then we put in the contract, you know, a $50 difference, and I'm the one who suffers that $50 loss, that's my mistake. I should have looked at the contract, verified it. That's probably going to slide. Now, if it's like a $1,000 difference and you see the contract and you're like, oh, look at the $1,000 difference, I hope this idiot doesn't find out, then it's, you're going to have taken advantage of me. But if it's just a slight error that one party, took on the responsibility and it's their fault, so we're talking about a unilateral mistake, then it's going to be part of the contract. A mutual mistake, you're absolutely correct. There was no meeting of the minds. If there's a mutual mistake, we were both confused about an essential term of the contract. Like one example I can remember is, hey, I need a tow. I'm looking at it and it looks to be about 8 feet deep. Can you come bring out your tow truck? Sure, it's gonna be $100. Hey, just to let you know, buddy, our tow truck only goes 10 feet. All right, bet. Guy comes out. It's 12 feet. We thought it was 8 feet. You thought it was 8 feet. I thought it was 8 feet. There's no contract, right? It was a mutual mistake because it was essential that it was under 10 feet. They only had a 10-foot thing to come out. So that's an example. Mutual mistake is void, rescindable by both parties. Unilateral mistake is rescindable by the party that was mistaken only if the non-mistaking party should have known of the mistake and essentially took advantage of the other party. If they didn't know about it and it was just a minor mistake, then you have to live with your mistake. We talked about these. Executor, the promises to by executors, administrators, or personally answer for the debts, and guarantees, promises to pay for the debt of another. Okay. Sign writing, party be charged. Parole evidence rule. When we think about parole evidence, we think about contemporaneous evidence to a contract that we're typically not gonna allow, asterisks, 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 because they always allow it on the fucking test. Like, it's always, not always, it is very often an exception. We know the rule that, you know, extrinsic evidence to a written agreement is inadmissible to supplement or contradict the written agreement. We know that. But when are the times when it is admissible? Who out there can give me some examples?
When there was a condition.
Right, to show that there was some condition. So, you know, the contract would only be if I got the job, and now we have evidence of that condition, that'll be brought in to contradict the contract. What's another example? The big one is going to be to clarify ambiguous terms, right? Like if there's some term used in here that we don't know, you know, what they mean by a bag of money. Is it a big bag or a small bag? And we have evidence to show that a bag of money means like a Publix bag. That could be brought in to clarify ambiguous terms. Another one that we see here is going to be a formation defense, right? If there was misrepresentation, fraud, or duress, we have evidence that this contract was formed under, you know, not ideal terms. Evidence necessary to determine there was a mistake, right? A mistake in the process of reducing it. So I really want people to pay attention to that and to understand that as an indicator of what kind of beast this test is. They don't just test you on the main rule. That would be way too easy for them. They like assume you know the rule and then they try to slide in the exception on you. Parole evidence is a great example. We know the main rule is that extrinsic evidence to a written agreement is inadmissible to supplement or contradict the written agreement. And we need to know that rule cold. We need to be able to just state it from memory. But then we also need to know these exceptions. And then we need to recognize when one of those exceptions is occurring. It's like a multiple step process. You're like, okay, this is parole evidence. It shouldn't be admitted. You're like, wait, but why is this evidence being admitted? Well, it's being admitted to show that this guy thought that the contract was about lemons, but it was really about limes. Oh, it's showing a mistake. Oh, a mistake is an exception to parole evidence. So we got to train ourselves to think like that. The hardest area, and I'm going to bring in some help for some of the subjects that I hate, is hearsay and evidence. I'll have Sam come in with me for that one. But you got to think like that. Like, okay, this is hearsay, but it's an exception. Is it one of those exceptions? Let me walk through it. So let's get, you know, used to thinking like that. Okay, something that nobody knows, FOB. Is actually free on board. I don't know why. I thought it was freight on board. Everyone thinks it's freight on board. It actually stands for free on board. But that's going to be an FOB when it's a shipment contract, meaning you've satisfied your obligation as soon as you've shipped it. You've delivered it to a common goods carrier, meaning I have an FOB contract. I'm supposed to sell lemons. Once I put lemons into the FedEx, I'm relieved from my duties. If FedEx messes up, not my fault. I have done my duties. Now, if it's not FOB, if it's a destination contract, then you actually are obligated to ensure that the, you know, goods arrive at the destination. We talk about that, the risk of loss, common carrier, the risk shifts to the buyer once they complete obligations, the FOB contract, and the risk of loss shifts to the buyer once he takes physical possessions for a merchant. And the non-merchant, it shifts upon tendering delivery. Kind of in the weeds right there, but all good. Don't worry, we're getting through this outline. I want to just make sure we get through it, and then we'll do practice questions. And then tomorrow we're going to be doing essays, contracts essays. So hopefully by the end of the weekend, everyone knows everything about contracts. Is anyone still alive out there?
We're alive.
We're here.
What's going on, Sam? Is it boring?
No, I mean, this is it. This is what you have to do. It sucks. Like, it really sucks. But you have to go over the material because you'll do the questions and you'll be like, what the hell? Like, I literally just had an FOB question the other day and I was like, what? I didn't even know this. I forgot what FOB even stands for. So it is what it is. This is the battle of the beast. That's how it goes.
I like that. It's the battle of the beast. You know, I have to do this. I have PowerPoints, I have like more fun ways of teaching, but it's my duty to go over very thoroughly so that we see when we do the questions, which we're going to do in the second half of class today, where the answer came from. The answer does come from, you know, the fine lines. It's a very difficult test, one subject at a time. We're actually, you know, I don't like this saying, killing two birds with one stone. I don't know who the fuck is out here killing birds with stones, but we're doing two things at one time right now with with this outline because it's going to help us with the particularities of the MBE questions, but also hearing the way I'm reciting, I need you guys to start reciting in your own words because the speed on the essays is critical. Being able to just do the foundation of what is a contract, UCC versus common law, what is the predominant purpose test, offer acceptance consideration, valid defenses, statute of frauds, mistake, all the other defenses. Like, the faster you can just write them out and use the proper terms, then you can actually think about, all right, now what is this question even asking? What other things do I need to look for? But you need to get the foundation down cold. So that's what I'm doing here. Killing two birds with one stone. I'm repeating myself a lot so that, you know, the memory kicks in and we're trying to leave no stone unturned. All right, warranties. This will come up in torts too when we do product liability. But remember this implied warranty of merchantability and implied warranty of fitness for a particular purpose. Those are going to be implied warranties on the sale of products. And then express warranties is like, you know, hot on the word hot on the McDonald's coffee. And that lady poured it on her pants on purpose. Express warranties versus implied warranties. So you can limit warranties by liability by contract by having a disclaimer, as is with all faults, or remedy limitation. Like in this case, this is, you know, we're limited from providing remedies, things of that nature. Okay, so that's UCC terms, warranties. We already talked about perfect tender. So seller's performance must be perfect with respect to the goods delivered and the manner of delivery. Imperfect tender, the buyer has the option to retain or reject non-conforming goods. If the seller's performance is not perfect, they can retain goods delivered and sue for damages, reject some or all goods and sue for damages. We crushed that earlier. That's good. I like to know that we're good. Rejection for imperfect tender, they must notify the seller of rejection in reasonable time. They must hold the rejected goods using reasonable care. That's a good one. You can't be like negligent and just let the goods get way worse, or you could be actually responsible for that. And they must give the seller reasonable time to arrange for the removal of the goods. Perfect tender, buyer after reasonable opportunity to inspect the goods, indicates the seller that the goods conform or that would keep them despite their non-conformance. That's acceptance, right? Payment without an opportunity to inspect is not acceptance. You always get that opportunity to inspect. If the buyer accepts goods, he cannot reject them later. You know, can't do that. Buyer fails to reject or notify seller rejecting within a reasonable time. That's going to be an acceptance if you just don't notify them that you've rejected that. The buyer generally cannot reject goods once he's accepted. He can revoke acceptance if the nonconformity substantially impairs the value of the goods. The buyer is excusably ignorant of the grounds for revocation or reasonably relies on the seller's assurance of satisfaction. The buyer revokes within a reasonable time after discovering nonconformity. So we're talking here about revocation of acceptance, meaning you've accepted. Typically, once you've accepted, like, you can't say, no, I don't accept, unless, you know, you're excusably ignorant or there's a reasonable time and you find out some nonconformity or something that is seriously wrong. Ultimately, with contracts questions on the MBE, when you're in doubt, take a step back and be like, okay, if I was a party to this contract, what would be the right thing to do to get the person who did nothing wrong back to where they should be? And then just kind of go with your gut. I'm not saying go with your gut often on the test. Usually you need to have a definite reason why you're picking each answer, but that's not always going to be the case. And when in doubt, same with torts. With torts, what's the reasonable thing here? What should happen? With contracts, okay, if I was a party to this contract, you know, what is supposed to happen? That'll help you out a little bit. We talked about, okay, opportunity to cure, right? The seller does have an opportunity to cure if the time for performance has not yet expired. They had reasonable grounds to believe they would be acceptable, and they give notice of intent to cure. So the buyer cannot impel seller to cure. He cannot say you must cure, you don't have to cure. You could just instead sue me for a breach. But we're gonna give the seller an opportunity to cure. Another time that this concept of curing in contracts is going to arise is when we have an installment contract. Does anyone out there just approve that someone's alive? Because sometimes I feel like I'm speaking to corpses. Know what an installment contract is?
Yeah, that's the contract that that the goods are going to be, what's the word? Can someone help me? Sorry.
It's like a series of performances that happen over time.
Yeah, a series of deliveries. Thank you.
Serial delivery, that's fair enough. Where every month I'm going to give you 30 lemons. Now, month one, 30 lemons. Month two, 30 lemons. Month three, 20 lemons. Is that a breach? Probably not, because you have an opportunity month four to send 40 lemons, right? If it's an installment contract, you have an opportunity to cure on the subsequent delivery. Okay, I know we're going to get into this anticipatory repudiation thing sooner or later, so make sure you guys know what that means before I get there. Perfect tender installment contracts. Oh man, I was literally just about to talk about that. I just did. Buyer's ability to reject due to is limited because they have that opportunity to cure. We're just talking about that. So breach, when we're writing a contract, we go through the simple procedure. What is a contract? What are the elements of a contract? What are the defenses to a contract? And then has a breach occurred? And the breach is going to be either substantial or immaterial, unsubstantial. If one party substantially performed, the other party is obligated to perform in complete performance. Less than perfect performance by one party does not excuse the other party from his obligation. Substantial is generally considered to be at least halfway complete. Thus, substantial performance by A obligates B to perform, but B may seek money damages for the difference between the performance rendered and the performance expected. So we want to look at, these are the, you know, this would be like a unilateral contract where I've substantially performed to a certain amount. You have to pay them to a certain amount and give them the opportunity to finish. Construction contracts. So Joel, you probably know a lot about this. Conditions and non-occurrence of conditions. Conditions are agreed upon limitations on performance. They make an obligation to perform contingent on the occurrence of some specific event or condition. So here, you know, it's not a breach if there's a condition that needs to occur and that condition doesn't occur and then you don't do what you're supposed to do. That's kind of what this means. Provided that until so long as condition precedent, performance not obligated unless the condition occurs, so that non-occurrence excuses performance, and condition subsequent, a condition that occurs after performance has begun and excuses further performance. So if we sell this many seats, then you got to keep doing the show. We don't sell that many seats, you're excused. Condition precedent means if, you know, the Dolphins make it to the Super Bowl, then you have to perform. Well, if they don't make it to the Super Bowl, then you're not obligated to perform. Right? If a condition exists, it must be strictly complied with, but substantial performance may suffice if it fulfills a condition's purpose. All right. This is a big one, anticipatory repudiation. And I like this outline because it's an MBE outline, but it still helps us put into buckets the things we need to know for a Florida contracts essay. At the top, it's the formation of a contract. What is the governing body of law? What are the rules that apply to merchants? You know, then what are the defenses and what are the breaches that have occurred? But then we want to start thinking about what are other things that are commonly tested in Florida that we need to know the specific laws for. We already talked about one of them, which was installment contracts and how they'll have that opportunity to cure. We talked about another one that they test, which is parole evidence. And parole evidence, understanding that concept of usually we're not going to allow this extrinsic evidence to contradict the terms of the fully integrated contract unless these certain exceptions apply, including ambiguous terms, contract formation, things like that. And then another big one that we're going to get to, and there's, I have at least five in my mind, but number three that we're going to see a lot on Florida contracts is going to be this concept of anticipatory repudiation. Can someone explain to me what that means, anticipatory repudiation?
It is when someone makes it clear that they are backing away from completing what their obligation was in the agreement or contract.
Right. One party has reason to believe that the other party is not going to do what they're supposed to do. So it's like, why would I continue holding up my end of the bargain when you're not holding up your end of the bargain? In fact, I know you're not going to hold it up. So trigger word for anticipatory repudiation, request for further assurances, right? And typically 30 days. When we're talking about merchants, UCC, you typically, if you believe that the other party is going to repudiate and not perform, you can request a written request for further assurances, in which they have 30 days to respond to either say, you're right, we're not going to do it, or no, we're actually going to do it. Like, if you think that they're going to repudiate and you make a request for further assurances and they say, no, man, we're actually going to perform, then like, there's not much you can do until they actually repudiate. But if they don't conform with that request for further assurances and you're like, all right, they're definitely going to repudiate, you have two options. You can either sue right away and be, you know, anticipatory repudiation, I'm suing, or you can wait until the breach actually occurs and sue then. So let's see what their little example is. A, or our little example. A hires B to remodel A's kitchen. B is almost finished with the remodel when A tells B that she has decided she does not want to remodel and will not pay B. This is anticipatory repudiation. She can treat as breach, stop work, and sue for damages. It can be reversed or retracted if they have not materially changed the position. The repudiating party can ask for adequate assurances. Yeah, I call further assurances. Okay, cool. So just kind of while my head is there, and you know, I bounce around a lot, but I try to stay focused as much as possible. When we're thinking about the essay and we're thinking about issues that are commonly tested in Florida that are kind of outside the gambit of of just the straight outline, I think of anticipatory repudiation. I think of parole evidence. I think of installment contracts. Another one I think of is non-competes. And I know we'll get there, but let's do some foreshadowing. Can anyone tell me what is particular about a non-compete agreement? What do they need to be reasonable in? What three elements?
Scope, geography, and duration.
Right. They need to be reasonable in subject matter, geographic scope, and duration. What are some estimations in Florida of what's reasonable for these, you know, for years? 6 months, right? Usually not to exceed 6 months, but if it's certain areas, it could be 2 or 3 years, like, you know, patents or things like that. But what we want to know about non-competes is a non-compete agreement has to be reasonable in duration, how long it is, 6 months or 2 years, geographic scope, which you're going to look towards the actual business. Like, geographic scope could be different for a painter than it is for a lawyer, you know, just it could be a different area. And then subject matter. You can't have a non-compete agreement that restricts someone from doing much more than what's in the subject. So that's another one that I think of as I want to make sure we have down well. Anticipatory repudiation, parole evidence, installment contracts, and non-competes. Okay. These three things right here, I talked about earlier, I kind of gave a talk about. What's the difference between novation and a delegation and an assignment, and what is an accord and satisfaction? These are all terms we definitely want to know. So rescission is the mutual cancellation of a contract. We know what rescission is. We rescind the contract, mutual mistake, there'll be no contract. Modification is going to be, you know, a substitution of an agreement. We could have a difference between accord and satisfaction and a modification, right? Under accord and satisfaction, satisfaction of the accord is a condition for fulfillment of the original contract obligations. A modification is a new agreement replacing the old agreement. So an accord and satisfaction just means we're going to have this different performance that'll satisfy the old performance. It's usually in terms of debt. Like if you pay off this, it'll satisfy that prior debt. Where a modification is literally a totally new contract that we change the terms. Old contract doesn't exist. We're not saying that we have necessarily satisfied that contract. Okay, so novation. A novation is going to actually be a substitution of a new party. So me and Ben agree to terms, and then we have a novation where Ben is going to substitute himself for Joel. Ben is totally off the hook from this contract. Now it's just between me and Joel. That's a novation. A novation is very different than an assignment or delegation, because under an assignment or delegation, then the original party is still liable under the contract, right? Do we see the difference between that? So remember, we delegate duties, we assign rights. Delegate duties, meaning I'm supposed to perform. You're going to pay me to paint the house. I delegate the duty to paint the house to Brian. Now, Brian doesn't paint the house. He can sue me, you know, still, I'm still original party to that. I just delegated it. You know, we can think of that. I delegated the duty, but I'm still a party to the contract. An assignment would be the opposite. Now, instead of Ben paying me, he's going to assign Joel to pay me. He's going to be the one who's assigned paying under the contract. Still, Ben is a party to the contract. If you want to get yourself completely off the contract, you need to have a novation. A novation will completely substitute a party for another party. Okay, so we talked about assign rights, delegate duties, novate new parties. Rescission, you totally rescind the contract. Accord and satisfaction, how it differs from a modification, is this is an agreement that'll explicitly extinguish or terminate, what they say? Satisfy. It'll satisfy the obligations of the previous contract, where a modification is going to turn the old contract into a new contract. Similar, but a little different. All right. The hardest thing on the MBE contracts is this TPB thing, third-party beneficiaries. Who is a TPB and who's not a TPB? So we understand what TPB means. TPB means someone who is a beneficiary of the contract, but not the person who offered or accepted the contract. Fair enough? Let's give an example. Me and my brother Brian make an agreement that we're going to pay $200 a month into a fund for my father. Now, first month, I put in $200. My brother puts in $200. My father gets $400. Next thing the next month. Then 1 month, my brother doesn't put in his $200. Can my father sue my brother? I assume we're like a really messed up family. For that $200 as a third party beneficiary. Does he have rights to sue my brother in this contract? If this is an MBE question written exactly as such, anyone want to think they have an idea?
There's a chance. If he was like expressly designated as the beneficiary, then he would have rights.
Yes, I said we made a contract naming my father. He's going to get the money. He relies on it. Every month he's getting the $400. You have now vested and become a beneficiary. Go ahead.
Does he have to rely on it?
Yeah, there has to be relying on it. But in this scenario, he's been receiving it. That would constitute reliance, like
okay. The
months of receiving it. What do we look for? I'm telling you, these are hard. We're going to have to go through the questions to really distinguish, but what we're really looking for, are they named in the contract? That's a good one. Like, these payments are going to my dad, and the other one, have they relied upon it? Have they actually started receiving the benefits and using the benefits, especially if it said like, my father has been using the payments to pay for his bills or something, you know, that would be a crucial one. That's when we're going to have the vesting. The rights must vest. How do they vest? They assent to the promise in a manner requested, they bring suit, or they materially change position in justifiable reliance on the promise. So if a third party does not meet the above, she's incidental and does not have any rights. So incidental versus express, expressly designated in the contract, like I said, directly benefit and stand in such position that there's an intent to benefit can be inferred. So here's another example. And I'm literally thinking directly of a question I remember. I have a contract with a cleaning service. I own a hospital and I have a contract with a cleaning service, and the cleaning service promises that the rooms will be cleaned to such a perfect standard as to conform with some statute. Then they don't conform with that statute. They do a bad job cleaning. One of the hospital patients gets super sick as a result of the bad cleaning. Can that hospital patient sue the cleaning service? Don't be afraid, this is hard because I think
they're probably— No, they can't.
The answer is no, they can't. They're not a express beneficiary. Right, they were not named in the contract. They were not intended to benefit from it. What would you say? How would you explain that?
The person will be incidental because, like you said, they're not stated in the contract. They're just merely receiving the benefit of this cleaning service. There's nothing in the contract that requires them to benefit from that agreement.
Exactly. Excellent. So I'm telling y'all, I'm focusing on this TPB, third-party beneficiary, because I've been doing this for long enough that I know that this is an area, a tricky area. So we're going to hopefully do some of these questions. So who can sue? The TPB can sue the promisor. They can assert in their own defenses. The promisor can assert in the promisee's defenses. A promisor may not absolutely promise to pay. Promisee can sue promisor at law and equity for specific performance. TPB can only sue promisee if TPB is a creditor beneficiary. So creditor TPB's benefit is conferred based on a debt owed by the promisee of the contract. The donee TPB's benefit is conferred gratuitously. So they're a donee if their benefit is gratuitous. They're a creditor if their debt is owed by, is based on a debt owed. A little bit in the weeds right there. I don't want to focus on that. Rights of TPBs, in order to enforce the rights of a contract, a TPB's rights must vest. And we talked about that. To enforce the rights, they have to vest. How do they vest? They assent to the promise, they bring suit, they materially change position. So we're just looking for some of these words and kind of looking for those examples. We're going to get a bunch of them wrong. I've never stressed this enough. It's much better getting questions wrong than getting them right. If you're just getting questions right over and over and over again, hooray, you're a genius and you have like good guessing skills, but you're not learning anything. You learn the best when you get it wrong, especially when you like are sure you're right and then you get it wrong and then you're forced to be like, why did I get that wrong? We're trying to spark as many of those types of moments as possible so that, you know, they stick in their memory, in your memory. All right, what else do we have in here? Assignment, we talked about transfer of rights. You assign rights, you delegate duties. Typically you can always assign, right? Common law bars assignments that substantially change the duties of the obligor. Assignment of payment is not a substantial change. Assignment of rights of performance is a substantial change. I mean, like, I think of like the subletting thing. You know, you can typically always sublet unless they tell you that you can't. When it comes to these questions, don't look for that as the answer usually. Like, oh, they were barred from assigning. Like, unless it explicitly said they were barred from assigning, they probably weren't, or delegating. You know, like, you could probably delegate the duty to make the chocolate chip cookies to another chocolate chip cookie provider as long as it's not affecting the contract. Contractual limitation on the right to assign, take away the right to assign but not the power to assign. That would be a prohibiting assignment versus an invalidating assignment would take away both the right and power to assign. Delegation, generally duties may be delegated, no formal. So it's easier to delegate than assign. Remember, assigning is like who's going to pay. Delegate is who's going to actually perform the duty. Duties are non-delegable if it involves personal judgment and skill. Like, if I hire a Aerosmith and then they bring out a different band, like, oh, sorry, we're getting this band to play. Like, that's not cool. You can't delegate, personal skill, personal judgment. Parties place special trust in the delegator. Contractual provision restricts it. So again, contracts, we have the right to contract. That's why you are all lawyers, so that you can write really detailed contracts that, consider the terms that people want to agree upon. You're allowed to do that to most extents. So one of the fifth things I wanted to talk about in my kind of list of what's tested on the Florida bar that's, outside the straight outline. And I said parole evidence. I said non-competes. I said installment contracts. I said anticipatory repudiation. Fifth one is liquidated damages. Can anyone tell me what a liquidated damages clause means?
It's when sometimes the damages are hard to calculate. So on the onset of the contract, they go ahead and say that if there's a breach, this is what the damages will be.
Right. And I'm not, I'm just thinking, because Joel's father and my uncle do construction law, that I'm going to talk about construction law a lot. But that's an area you'll definitely see liquidated damage clauses in, are in construction contracts. Like, time is of the essence. We need the electricity, just one element of the whole building done by this date. And if it's not done by this date, the damage will be X amount of dollars per day, right? We're calculating that ahead of time, because in the midst of it all, it would be so difficult to calculate, well, what's the damage because the electricity is going to push back the stucco, which is going to push back the, it's so hard to calculate that. So liquidated damages clauses, which are usually disfavored, they're usually going to be stricken for we don't like liquidated damages clauses, but sometimes they are going to be allowed if they're reasonable. I think they usually have a 10%, is typically reasonable. Contemplation, because the damages will be so hard to contemplate in the moment. So that'd be liquidated damages. Good job. Okay, cool. Now we get to damages. Damages is kind of like a trick of mine that I have when it comes to writing essays. Number one, write ethics first. When you get an essay and they say, what are all the ethical issues? Do that first and crush that, because ethics is the only subject on the essays you're guaranteed to get. You might as well knock that one out of the park. Don't run out of time and be like, oh, there are some ethical issues that, make sure you crush that one. By the same token, I believe that for damages, right? If they say include damages, you might as well at least write your little paragraph, there are two types of damages available at law for contracts, for breach of contract claims, legal and equitable. Legal damages are monetary. They include expectation, consequential, incidental, some others. And equitable damages are imposed by the court, and they include reformation, rescission, quasi-contract. We'll go down the list, but I'm just saying, at least have that tree in your head of, okay, I'm going to talk about damages. I'm going to separate them into legal and equitable. I'm going to list them all out. And then I'm going to decide what's most appropriate in this case. Usually it's going to be expectation damages, right? What the party would have received if the contract was completed. And then expectation leads to consequential. Those are damages that are foreseeable if the contract was going to be breached. And then incidental is going to be what you had damages you incurred as a result of recovering for the breach. Like maybe you had to, do this or that. And then nominal means in name only. So, if you ever hear that word, nominal damages, that's not what you want. If you ever sue someone and you win nominal damages, that means you got a sticker saying you won, but you didn't actually get any money. You're going to be entitled to potentially lost wages, lost profits. These are the monetary damages that we're thinking of when we think of legal damages. There's one that is kind of in the middle, which is restitution, because restitution is kind of court ordered, but it is a monetary damage. And I swear I've seen it listed as a legal damage or an equitable damage. So it kind of crosses the line right there. But then when we think about equitable damages, we're thinking more of these court ordered things Like I said, reformation, we're going to reform the contract. Rescission, we're going to say the contract never actually existed. The quasi-contract, where we're going to make a contract when there isn't one. Let's see what else we got here. The most important one, specific performance. I had a brain lapse right there. That's the most important equitable damage, specific performance. At the top of your list, when it comes to legal relief, you're thinking expectation damages. At the top of your list, when you're thinking of equitable relief, you're thinking specific performance. So specific performance, land, every piece of land is unique. Art, every piece of art is unique. I think two administrations ago for the Florida bar exam, there was a thing about photos. Panther 1 and Panther 2. You know, they won Panther 1, they got Panther 2. Immediately, I'm going off on that. You are entitled to the specific performance of Panther 1 because it's a piece of art and pieces of art are unique. So that's what we're talking about there. Going back, what are the different types of damages? Expectations, standard measure, that's going to be legal damages. Monetary relief puts the party in the same economic position the contract been performed. When in doubt, look for the answer that most closely gives the plaintiff the money they would have received absent the breach. Reliance damages, you know, they're hard, but if you relied on the contract to compensate based on their performance, puts the parties in the same economic position as if it had never been formed. So you get that money back. Duty to mitigate, you always in contract law have a duty to mitigate damages. You can't just let damages go crazy. You gotta, stop the bleeding at some point. Let's see, specific performance, when there's no adequate remedy at law, money damages don't work. Real estate, antiques, art, never available for service contracts because that would be like, not slavery, but involuntary servitude. You can't just like force people to like serve you. Okay, so legal relief, we talk about expectation, consequential, foreseeable. That's the word for consequential. It has to be foreseeable. Incidental, reasonable, as a result of, cost of inspecting, returning, storing that. Restitution, arising contract, quasi-contract situations, if there's unjust enrichment. So we think of that word unjust enrichment for restitution and quasi-contracts. Liquidated damages, we talked about. Provisions that stipulate specified damages upon the occurrence of a breach. They're valid only if it's too difficult to project at the time and there's a reasonable estimation. We do some math here. Fair market value of perfectly delivered goods minus the fair market value of the goods actually delivered. If it's not perfect tender, you get, and you're trying to calculate how much you owe, it's like the market value difference. We're gonna do a lot of this math and the questions do get hard. Actually, that's the last slide. Never mind. I'll talk about it. I was going to fly through it, but okay. Damages, whichever the following is higher, fair market value of goods at the time of the breach minus contract price, or buyer's cost of recovering, replacing the goods minus the contract price. So that's when they keep or return the goods. A seller can recover the lost profits from buyer's breach, even though she resold the item that was sold at the buyer's breach, if she can prove that she would have made the sale to the second buyer regardless of the first buyer's breach. So that's like an interesting one. It's like, I'm gonna sell you a car, you breach, and then I resell the car for the same price. You don't actually have any damages because you were able to resell it. You know, like that's a way, but if you resell it for less money, then you could get lost profits. Okay, I'm boring myself here, but the good news is we made it all the way through. This outline for contracts MBE, and I'm gonna do that for some of the outlines we do, but contracts is a very thorough one that I want to make sure we do well. Just going back into seeing what other things we have, we have some PowerPoints, we have some MBE questions that we could do. I'm gonna pull up live questions, just kind of seeing if we missed anything. Just so y'all know what's on the MBE. Answer 9 questions every 15 minutes. It's not a bad strategy. I like this approach. formation, learning pad, review pad method, formation, breach, third-party contracts, parole, evidence rule. Write down the topic for the answer if you got it wrong or right for the right reason. Right, like, try to, you know, as we're doing this approach of getting questions right or wrong and writing it out, try to identify what is the subject that's being tested. What's the sub-subject? Is it a formation question? Is it a breach question? Is it a TPB? Is it a parole evidence rule? And you'll see how we do that. Right here, huge on multiple choice questions in general. Stay away from answers like never, rarely. You know, that single word can just turn you off of the question. 25% is on formation. 25% is going to be on performance, breach, and discharge. 12.5% on defenses to enforceability. 12.5% on contract, content, and meaning. 12.5 to remedies, 12.5 to third-party rights. I'm telling you all, and people can validate this, the contracts MBE questions are hard. They're really hard. That's why I start there. Because even when you're a master of contracts, even today when we do questions live, we're going to get some wrong together and be like, wow, that was a really hard question. So with that being said, the essays are a little bit easier to manage because you can just regurgitate that memorized outline of what is a contract. So these are hotly tested quest topics for the MBE contracts. And I'm going to end it here and take a little break, and then we'll end class today by doing live questions. But these are the hotly tested topics: parole evidence rule, full integration, partial merger clause, when is a document or oral statement from before or after, revocations, counter offers, merchants, common law versus UCC, third party rights, assignment, delegation, and when does that vesting occur, anticipatory repudiation, specific performance, equitable remedy, art, real estate, talked about that. Other types of damages, damages at law, expectation, remedial and restitution. Remedial is, you know, we don't see that as much. That's more punitive torts in that field. Limitations to damages, mitigation, certain ability, foreseeability, novation, we talked about, a new party, implied or express warranties. Here's an example, just a last thought. So you have a teacher who, you know, is supposed to get a job for $40,000 and she prepares for it. And then they say, you know what? Sorry, we're not going to give you that job. So then she has an offer to be a secretary for $40,000, same price. What's the maximum she could sue for the breach of contract? A lot of people would think, oh, well, you have a duty to mitigate. She can get another job for $40,000. There are no damages. The key to that question is what I said is she had an offer to be a teacher for $40,000. Now she has another opportunity to be a secretary for $40,000. You do not need to take that job as a secretary. If she had another job as a teacher for $40,000, we would be right that, you know, she has a duty to mitigate, take that job. There are no damages. But when it comes to mitigation, especially in like that employment sense, your only duty to mitigate is reasonable. You don't have to take a different job than you're expecting. So in the situation where $40,000 offer, they breach, now you have another offer to be a secretary, you could sue for $40,000. Now, $40,000 to be a teacher, they breach, you get another job to be a teacher for $35,000. Now you could sue for $5,000, right? Because you do have a duty to mitigate, take that job for $35,000 as long as it's comparable, and then you have that $5,000 mitigation. So we're going to take a little break, but before we do, does anyone have any questions or thoughts about anything at all? This class goes from 11 to 2, so we spent the first class kind of getting to know each other. We spent the second class going through the outline, which we did pretty diligently, and then we're going to spend the third part of class just doing live questions together. And I think this will be good for people to see what MBE questions look like, to kind of see how I approach them, and to see how, you know, they're tricky little devils. So why don't we actually, if you all don't mind, take a full like 8-minute break, and we'll start back at 1:30. Sound good to everyone? And then we'll spend the last 30 minutes just doing practice questions. All right, cool. I'm gonna Stop the recording.